Hello, my name is Jeanne Boyarsky. I'm a Java developer. I moderate the testing forum at Java Ranch and the testing exam at Java Black Belt. I'm here today to talk about automated defect prevention. So as developers, how do we normally test our work? We've learned from the past few days it's common to use a framework like XUnit and possibly an automated build tool, Ant or Maven or something else for the language of your choice. So we write our tests. We know they all have value for regression tests. What's the next step after that? We could take this to the next level and foresee the defects that are going to come up. If we can guess what's coming next, we can prevent them before they even get to QA, before they become defects, ideally either that day or that night. So let's take a look at, well, how can we do this? There are certain places that defects tend to congregate. Like say I write a method to log an object to the database. I have all of the fields in my object, I log them, I assert that I log the fields that I expected. Then I go on and I add a new field to the object and I never look at my method again. If I had written the test in the first place to inform me if a new field was added, I'll know as soon as that happens. So that's the kind of thing that automated defect prevention is about, checking things that can happen before they happen so you know as soon as your defect is introduced into the code base. It's not just limited to code. Our software is the whole deliverable. If we have a Java project, we've got a jar file. If we have a website, we have a web project. The entire thing is the deliverable, and any defects in any part of it are going to be held against us. If we can't deploy, we don't have a product at all, so it's pretty useless. So we can write tests either in JUnit and Ant in our framework of choice that are going to check for things like that. If I'm missing a jar file, if I'm pointing to a directory that doesn't exist, if I have two copies of the same file, all these things are problems when I deploy. It may work on my machine, but it sure isn't going to work on the server, and that's what matters. So if we can have a program tell us that something's wrong here ahead of time, we'll know that we don't even need to bother to deploy this. We have a bug. I broke it when I accidentally changed this, and I can fix it before something else happens. Similar deployment errors are most of us deploy to many environments. You've got a development server, a QA server, a production server. You don't want to hear, well, it worked in QA, but it didn't work in production. That's not good. We want it to not work in QA or not work on our machines in the first place. So that's something else we can automate. If we forgot to set some property, if we didn't centralize the information, we can know about it right away so that it may work on our machine, but it won't work in QA. So by the time we get to production, we know what didn't work in QA. We've learned from that experience, and we can prevent the defect from happening there. Other types of automated defect prevention are things that have to do with the quality of our software. Code coverage, static analysis rules, these are the things that came up over the last 2 days. Anything that can be run in an automated fashion is a candidate for being a part of automated defect prevention. Another interesting side effect of this is that it can be used for training. If you get new people on your team, and maybe you forget to tell them something, or they thought it wasn't important, or they forgot because there was so much information in this first day, they'll see that, oh, they made this change and this test failed, and that's a reminder that, oh yeah, I have to go back and change this so that it's not a problem. So in closing, with automated defect prevention, it's both a training tool and a way of finding your defects as early as possible so they don't become defects and they don't count. Thank you.